Thanks, Miguel. Good morning, everybody. I was being told that your yesterday's presentations were quite depressing. So the only task I had this morning was to lift you all up again. So you should have hired a comedian. When I came here, I actually don't live in London, but for Miguel, I decided to wake up early. I have a great respect for Miguel and be here this morning. I have to fly off right away to Singapore. But when I flew in yesterday night late, I was actually at the airport and I heard three people talk to each other. And now my wife always tells me don't listen in because it's very impolite, but I know you all do, so I'll share the story anyway. But I quickly discovered that one was a doctor and one was an economist and one was an engineer. And they actually were bragging. You know, when these three people go together, they start bragging. And the doctor said, you know, we have the oldest profession in the world. If you go back to the book of Genesis, Eve came out of the ribs of Adam. Both of them survived. Successful operation. Oldest profession. So it's interesting. So the engineer said, I don't think so. I think we have the oldest profession. Because think about the universe, how well organized it is. There was big chaos. We arranged it, created the universe. Who in the world makes order out of chaos? That's what engineers do. So engineers have the oldest profession. So the economist said, that's not true. We have the oldest profession because who created chaos in the first place? So this is where we are. Have I lifted you up already enough? Or? Anyway, thanks for being here and for the opportunity to talk to you. And Dave and Rob, obviously a great organization. Hadn't heard of Arthur Pace, to be honest, but when I read that, he said already 80 years ago that real success lies in enterprises conducting itself in the public interest and in such a way that the public will give it sufficient freedom to serve effectively. He could have said that today, and it probably would have been more relevant even than 80 years ago. I think the definitions have changed, and we're basically on the crossroad. Undoubtedly, my friend Martin talked about that yesterday, and I think he had Brexit on this title, but I'm sure he talked a little bit about the broader economic environment that we're in. But a lot of people are questioning capitalism. I actually don't want to give you that impression that we need to question capitalism. I don't want to really spend much time on the word capitalism. I frankly don't really care. But I do believe that we have to evolve capitalism. How many are Americans in the room? Just raise your hands. Don't worry about it. I won't attack you. I'm married to one already for 37 years, so I have the right to criticize. I'm from the Netherlands, by the way, and my wife is from Wisconsin. And in those days, the Dutch got subsidies to marry Americans, and which was very attractive to me. And I thought the best I could do is go for a cheesehead. In fact, we met, believe it or not, at university in a class called collective bargaining, and we're still working at it. She was there for the, she's a musician, she plays cello in an orchestra and has a quartet or trio. And she was there to study access equity, you know, in those days. And I was there obviously for my business degree, AFL-CIO, defending the employers. So we hit it off right away from the beginning. But anyway, let me see what we can talk. Although you've probably, capitalism. So as you, most of you are Americans, all I'm advocating is to evolve capitalism, just like Franklin Roosevelt did with the New Deal. In fact, Europe is not many things are growing, but one of the things that is actually growing in Europe are books about capitalism. Capitalism at risk, conscious capitalism, capitalism on a crossroad, new capitalism. Whenever you Google Amazon.com, you get probably about 50 or 100 references of capitalism. So I was flying back the other day with my wife from India, and I said, I'm going to write a book. And she said, well, you promise never to write a book as long as you're in office, because I have this theory that if you write a book as a CEO in office, you're basically out the next year. And that seems to sort of have a high correlation. But she said, when are you going to write about it? I said, I'm going to write a book about capitalism, because it's a growth industry. And she said, capitalism. I said, yeah. And so she said, what are you going to call it? I said, I have the title. I call it 50 Shades of Capitalism. So if you all can donate a chapter to me, that would be very good. And I'll promise I'll publish the book. The issue that we have, obviously, is one of evolving capitalism. And that's what we need to work on. And that's where you come in. It's actually the best time to be born. I just had a granddaughter, and it's a great moment to come into this world. More people than ever have been lifted out of poverty in the last 4 decades. In fact, over 500 million. People will say that's China, it's always something, but actually more people have been lifted out of poverty. More people live beyond the age of 5. More people than ever have access to clean drinking water. And yes, actually more women are participating in the real economy or workforce than at ever time in people's history. And frankly, medical advances have also made us live longer than any time in human history. It's the best time to be born. There is no question about it. But then the second thing that goes in the same breath is, if you look at the crisis of 2007-2008, I think there is increasingly, unfortunately slower than I would like it, but there's increasingly a recognition that the system with which we have created this enormous advance in human well-being is not in itself sustainable. The crisis of 2007-2008 made us realize that although we had lifted these hundreds of millions of people out of poverty, we had done it in a way that gave us incredible levels of private and public debt, that gave us an unsustainable consumption pattern, putting pressures on the world's scarce resources, increasingly so. And last but not least, is frankly leaving too many people behind. And in any system where too many people feel that they are left behind or not participating, will ultimately rebel against itself. And that is what you're seeing. Now, unfortunately, the crisis was about nearly 10 years ago. And the question you have to ask yourself, have we learned anything? And the answer is, unfortunately, not much. Because of quantitative easing and the money we've pumped in since the crisis, the global debt has gone up by $57 trillion. There's more money floating around this world than we know what to deal with. That's why interest rates are zero or many places now negative. We've basically run out of tools on monetary policy. In fact, what we've done by not changing our system, we have fed even more so the capital markets. And that's why you see a few people becoming billionaires and the few that play the capital market doing very well. Our system is designed to reward capital nowadays and not labor. Not surprising we haven't generated any jobs. Not surprising now that you have 1% of the population now, for the first time, that has the same wealth as the other 99%. In fact, you can take the top 62 richest people, and I know them all by name. The 62 richest people have the same wealth as the bottom 3.5 billion people. The Gini coefficient, as they call it, of income inequality has gotten dramatically worse since the crisis. So on the debt level, I would say we score an F, a clear F. We haven't learned anything. Then if you look at the leaving many people behind, unfortunately, we're at the point that we are seeing the thing reverse, that more people are falling back into poverty. The US, 40, 50 million people living now below the poverty line, middle class eroding. You might think it's a developing market issue, but the same here in the UK, 1 out of 5 live below the poverty line. Issues of stunting that used to be only in the developing market are coming back to the developed markets. And then last but not least, I don't have to tell you, on planetary boundaries, although I don't get very excited anymore about the 2% that is still there as climate change deniers, but our linear consumption pattern of digging in the earth, producing and dumping it again has not really changed. In fact, in 30 years' time, there will be more plastic in the oceans than fish. And it's already entering the fish food chain and ourselves. 10% of the packaging maximum gets recycled and 90% gets ditched. And that's just one example. Our 2-degree trajectory, which now I think most of us, if not nearly all of us, agree that we need to stay below. And thank God the US and China just last week signed the Paris 20 COP21 agreement. But it requires drastic action to have a peak by 2050 requires us to do far more now already than the climate change agreement is calling for. Now, the good news in all of this is not the bad news I'm sharing with you, that we are slipping back again or that we still have a job to do. The good news is that we actually have the answer of what we should be doing. And anybody who understands this and actively participates has a bright future. Never, ever have there been more opportunities than now. The fact that 800 million people still go to bed hungry every night, not knowing if they wake up the next day, is a tremendous opportunity for food companies if they understand how to tap into that market. The fact that 2.5 billion people in this world still don't have access to clean water or sanitation is a tremendous opportunity if you're in the toilet cleaning business or if you're in the hygiene or in the water business. The fact that we still have 6 million children die below the age of 5 of infectious diseases, pneumonia, diarrhea, is a tremendous opportunity if you're in the hand washing business. Probably one of the cheapest solutions to address this. And frankly, none of us in the audience had to worry about dying before the age of 5. None of us had to worry about having access to education. None of us had to worry about going to bed hungry and not waking up the next day. And none of us had to worry about dealing with issues of open defecation or sanitation or clean drinking water. We've been very fortunate. But as we have been very fortunate, our only duty should be to be sure that others have that same opportunity. The fact that I was born in the Netherlands makes me stand here. I could have been born in sub-Sahara Africa. I wouldn't even have been here anymore. Life expectancy is below my current age. Isn't it our responsibility to put ourselves to the service of the common good? And as we do that, we will actually discover that we're better off ourselves as well. We're actually at the point in human history where the cost of not acting to create a more inclusive and sustainable society is actually going to be higher than the cost of acting. We'd be stupid not to do it. At a time that the business is desperately looking for growth, desperately looking for job creation, desperately looking to attack some of these fundamental issues that lead to Brexit or the current election phenomena in the US, we actually have the answers. And the answers actually are the Sustainable Development Goals. When we started in the year 2000 with the Millennial Development Goals, which was done at that time by Kofi Annan, who was leading the United Nations, it had a very simple goal: to halve the number of people living in poverty in this world. At that time, it was defined as $1.25. Now it's $1.90. And lo and behold, as I mentioned before, we've actually achieved that. It was great progress. But what we also understand is you can't go halfway. When the Americans went to the moon, they didn't turn around halfway. The Russians might have, but you went on at least. I think one of the reasons your mission was successful was because Kennedy said, "We'll get you safe back to Earth." One of the reasons the Russians never made it before you, because they didn't promise anybody to get safe back to Earth. There's something in human motivation that you have to work on. But you didn't go halfway. When Usain Bolt ran the 100 meters at the Olympics again and got his gold medal, he didn't stop at 50 meters and turned around. When you went to the wonderful concert of Beyonce in Central Park, celebrating the Sustainable Development Goals last year, she didn't stop halfway during her song and walked away. Why not finish the job? And in 2015, all countries in the world, 193 countries, rose to that challenge and signed up to the Sustainable Development Goals. Yes, it is a difficult time geopolitically. Yes, it is a difficult time to get the world to function together. We have probably more challenges than we had to deal with. But in September last year, 193 countries said, we are going to implement in the coming 15 years the Sustainable Development Goals. And the goal is very simple. It's a universal goal. Unlike the original Millennial Development Goals, which were more for the developing markets. And it's about irreversibly eradicating poverty in a more sustainable and equitable way. And it has 17 goals and 169 targets. It sounds like a lot, but with the complexity of the world, that's a pretty simple framework. Isn't that a wonderful goal? Don't you want to be part of that? And for a company, it makes total sense. I don't know about you, but there is absolutely no business case in enduring poverty. Likewise, companies cannot stay at the sidelines either of a system that gives them life in the first place. When I read the book of Viktor Frankl, who wrote his book, Man's Search for Meaning, he wrote something in there that always stuck to me. And he said very simply that when they built the Statue of Liberty on the east coast of the United States, tremendous symbol of what your great country stands for, they forgot to build the Statue of Responsibility on the west coast of the United States. You don't have liberty without responsibility. If we are fortunate enough, like we are, to belong to the 2%, to work for companies, have a job, can do what we want, to some extent financially liberated, then it's our responsibility to be sure that we also help the others. I'm not talking about equality, because I don't think equality will ever exist. We have to celebrate our differences. But I talk about equity, the opportunities for all of us, the access to work, the opportunity to have food, education. You don't have to be religious, but in any prayer, and in mine at least, give us this day our daily bread is given for everybody. So the Sustainable Development Goals actually are an enormous opportunity to make this world function with a payout that is enormous. $1 invested in nutrition gives you a $16 return for society. Some of the sub-Saharan countries, for which we pay an enormous price, the lack of security and all the other things, refugees, which we pay an enormous price right now, 10-12% of their GDP is lost because of the issue of stunting alone. $1 invested in nutrition has a $16 return. Giving women, one of the most discriminated parts of our society, happens to be 50%, small detail. Giving women the same access to financing, education, workforce as men, just giving them 1 year more of school would increase their income by 20% for the rest of their lives every year. Just giving them the same rights would increase the global economy by $30 trillion. By the way, this is a global economy of about $90 to $100 trillion. So we're not talking small things here. Any element of the Sustainable Development Goals are huge payouts for society. Why don't we take them? Why don't we take them? Now, the interesting thing is, we are willing to pay the cost that are higher. You know the cost in today's world of conflict prevention and dealing with conflicts? Does anybody have an idea how much the world pays on this? All the sad things going on from the Middle East to Africa to many other parts of the world now. Does anybody have an idea how much the world spends on dealing with conflicts right now? Make a guess. No, it's 9.7 trillion. 20 trillion would be a lot on the global economy of 100 trillion, but it's 10% of the global economy, 9.7 trillion. To develop, to implement the Sustainable Development Goals only has a cost of 2 to 3 trillion a year. 2 to 3 trillion a year. The cost of action is less than the cost of inaction. These 800 million people that go to bed hungry every day cost the world only 80 billion a year to feed them. 80 billion is less than the penalties we impose on banks these days. And I'm not trying to be funny, it's actually the reality. Banks have paid well over in excess of that in penalties, which we sort of think it's normal in this functioning society. And then at the same time, all of us are wasting 30 to 40% of the food that is being produced. 30 to 40% of the food that is being wasted by all of us has a total value of 800 to 900 million. 80 billion, 800 to 900 billion. 1/10. Doesn't make sense. The cost of inaction is significantly higher than the cost of action. I've never met a CEO in my life that wants more air pollution, that wants more unemployment, that wants more people going to bed hungry. I haven't met them. I believe in the goodness of anybody and everybody in this world. Then why don't we act on this? We don't act on this because I believe there are a few boundaries that actually make us behave a certain way that might not be conform with our inner selves or our own purpose or guiding lights. Same in the companies. If you put the wrong KPIs out there, you'll get the wrong behavior. You know that better than I do. If you reward the sales force on the number of invoices they write, you'll get an awful lot of invoices, but they will be very small. If you reward them on the total turnover growth, you'll get turnover growth. The boundaries in which we act are driving our behaviors. So if we want to change things, we need to change the boundaries in which we operate. Politicians have a hard time doing that because election cycles are too short. So they usually jump to attacking the outcomes and starting to deal with those versus going to the underlying causes. We in business understand that very well. But it requires three things in our boundaries that need to be moved. The first boundary that we need to move is the short versus the long term. Should not be a surprise. We've become caught up in the cycle of short-termism, which actually is getting worse, because if there's no return on money anymore in today's world, you'll get more of these activists trying to chase any short-term return they can with financial magouya. In the US alone, the total amount of money that is spent on share buybacks and special dividends now exceeds retained earnings. No wonder you don't get growth. Private companies, privately owned companies, spend three times more in capital than publicly traded companies. In fact, 75% of US CFOs, according to an article recently in Forbes, would postpone the right company's investments with positive NPVs if it affected their quarter's guidance versus expectations of the market. In fact, they're dancing to the pipes of these short-term shareholders at the expense of the long-term growth of their companies. We have to change the financial market short and long term. In fact, unfortunately, your Obama administration is coming to an end, but Biden has embraced this at a higher level than I've seen many other politicians in this world do. They're very interested to use the last few months of their administration to see if they can take some actions in one way or another that doesn't get boycotted by your legislative system. And we'll be talking that with them, and there are many efforts going on in the world to see if we can change these boundaries. And it's not just one thing. It's not just the CEO, it's the boards, it's the incentive systems on the financial market, it's the regulatory environment. We need to change that. If we want to address these fundamental issues that I talked about, these are not issues that can be solved on a quarterly basis. They need to be solved on the long term. The second boundary that we have to move next to short versus long term, I call that man versus nature. Hubert Reeves, who is a Canadian philosopher, he said, man is the most insane species. He worships an invisible god and destroys a visible nature, not realizing that the visible nature he destroys is the invisible god he worships in the first place. And that is exactly what we're doing. We're playing with the boundaries of our existence. Our resource use is already more than 1.5 Earths. I went to a simple school in the Netherlands, but at least I learned that we only have one Earth. Not to insult you as Americans, but if we live like Americans do, which a lot of people aspire to, for the good or for the bad, we already need today three Mother Earths. We only have one. So in order to be more respectful to the resource use now and for generations to come, which is in the interest of any company as well, we need to value it. If you don't measure it, you don't treasure it. That's why it's so important that we go into broader definition of success. A capitalist has been taught to optimize the return on capital. And frankly, you have to say they do that pretty well. That's what all the MBA programs teach you, and that's what all the businesses that you make your careers in teach you. A capitalist optimizes the return on capital. But what if we define that capital a little bit broader? What if we talk about environmental and social capital at the same time? Why don't we include those? What is wrong with that? If we put a price on water, we will be a little bit more careful with water, which frankly we're running out of. The same with carbon. If we think carbon is a problem for air pollution or global warming, whatever site you're on, put a price on carbon so that people value these things and start to take actions to mitigate the negative sides of it. Short versus long term, man versus nature. And the last barrier that we have to change is in our economic system that I talked about, which is few versus many. Any system where too many people feel they don't participate or are rejected or don't get benefits from will ultimately be rejected. We need to find an economic system that is more inclusive, where labor gets rewarded and where capital gets channeled to those parts of these economies that create this sustainable and equitable growth. That's how it used to be until the financial market thought that they were the reason for being in the first place. Money itself doesn't produce anything. It's a means to an end. And if we don't get back to that rapidly, we're digging ourselves into a deeper hole. Tax the use of resources, subsidize the use of labor, change financial laws to not favor the capital market. You talk about long term in the US, long term is 12 months, and you get your capital gains. That's not long term, it's not serious. Many of the hedge funds have a tax rate of less than 10%. And then they donate 50 million of their 1 billion they earned to a charity so they get some medals on their chest. By the way, the 50 million, they make sure it's tax deductible on top of that so that they have an effective tax rate of two times nothing and they're sort of humanitarian heroes. Change your tax laws. Change the tax laws in the US, change the tax laws in Europe to ensure that is you get a little bit more equitable growth. That's in the interest of everybody, by the way. That's not a socialistic thought. And business would benefit from that. If you're a company like Unilever, you'd benefit from having more people be able to buy your products. That's what Henry Ford's whole original idea was. And yet we're on a different trajectory. We're in the soup and soap business, a very simple business. But Bill Gates or Mark Benioff or many of the others who have done very well in this world, and I'm certainly not criticizing them, but they're not going to wash their hair more often or eat more food or drive more cars at the same time. It doesn't do anything for the economy. So as companies, we need to look at different business models. And as comms managers where you are, you need to take an active role in that. Because right now, the trust is very low. I know Edelman is here, and they issue the trust barometer every year. And trust in business is low. Trust in governments is low. It's not a happy period. Trust in CEOs is very low. And consumers or citizens of this world, which we all should be, are getting fed up with that. The only ones they trust, basically, are their own family members or occasionally someone else, but certainly not us. In order to create that prosperity, you need trust. Trust is the basis of prosperity. And in order to create trust, you need transparency. If you don't have transparency, there's no trust. If you don't have trust, there's no prosperity. So business needs to think about things a little bit differently. And in this age of transparency, by the way, the good thing about the internet, on this age of transparency, there's no place to hide. I normally take the Financial Times, I haven't picked it up this morning, but every day you can pick up a Financial Times and see the effects of misbehavior. From Sports Direct in the UK, not paying their people very well, to some of your tech companies paying a 1% tax rate and thinking that's normal, to manipulating LIBOR rates or foreign exchange rates, to letting wells explode in the Gulf because you want to save a little bit on your quarter and on your maintenance costs to make your quarter's estimates, to sell horse meat instead of beef, or to sell a $1 t-shirt from the Rana Plaza factory in Bangladesh because we only have to pay those people 11 cents an hour. By paying them 11 cents an hour, we can buy our $1 t-shirt. We think that's cool. Smart buy. We don't care that the factory collapses. 1,135 innocent women losing their lives. They knew darn well that that factory was about to collapse. 11 cents per hour is about as close as you can get to modern-day slavery, in my opinion. In fact, the next lowest country in the world is Vietnam at 26 cents an hour. People are waking up. It's not cool anymore to buy a $1 T-shirt. It's not cool anymore to buy from companies that are hiding behind big numbers or trade associations, saying one thing and lobbying the other thing. It's being flushed out at 100 miles an hour. No wonder that 65% of the growth in consumer goods companies in the US, the growth that is there in the market, comes from ethical companies or B Corps, neighborhood stores, the Kind Bars, the Ben and Jerry's of this world, the Tom's Shoes. No wonder that 75% of the graduates of US university don't want to work for big corporates anymore. They want to work for companies that have a purpose, that make a difference, where they can say, I left this world in a little bit better place than I found it. We're isolating ourselves by creating our own problem by not acting. By not acting for the common good. By not acting for the longer term. By not acting on the things that count. By being prisoners, if we like it or not, to our own self-interest. The race to the quarterly profits. The race to maximizing our stock options. The race to satisfying a few very focal shareholders. Where's the communications department in all of this? What role are you going to play? Staying on the sidelines? Explaining it to people? Or are you going to say, I'm belonging to the 2%, I'm actively being part of helping to transform this world to make it more inclusive for everybody? It's your choice, not my choice, it's your choice. I've made my choice. In Unilever, we decided to decouple our growth from environmental impact, increase our overall social impact. Unlike CSR, which just focuses on page 2 of the annual report, things under your own control, a part of your business, usually run by someone close to retirement. Does anybody see this movie Red Staple? Anybody see the movie Red Staple? Office Space, the movie is called Office Space. Does anybody see the movie Office Space? I recommend you to look at it if you haven't. It's actually a very funny movie, like the movie Airplane. But Office Space is about this guy that gets in the basement with a red staple. Anytime I see this movie, because it's one of those you want to see a million times, it reminds me of the way many companies run CSR. We need to snap out of that. Take responsibility of the whole value chain, not just the things under your control. Think about what you are going to publish. Driving these purposes into your brands. It's the best way to grow your brands. Brands with a stronger purpose, in even our definition of Unilever, grow twice as fast as other brands. And by the way, we as a company have grown twice as fast over the last 7-8 years as the total industry, in a market that frankly is not easy. And coming from a business, in our case, that actually was going down. We've redefined the purpose of all of our brands. Lifebuoy is not just selling bar soap. It's about helping a child reach the age of 5. Our leading disinfectancy brand, a toilet cleaner brand called Domestos, it's not just about disinfecting toilets. It's about giving people access to toilets. We're building 25 million toilets. Our food brands is helping to solve the problems of nutrition. Even our Dove brand that you know very well in the US stands for women's self-esteem. In a world where many women are frankly still too many discriminated against. All of our brands have social purposes. I don't have to talk to you about Ben and Jerry's. Save Our Swirled was one of our best ice creams in the US fighting climate change. Any brand that embraces that purpose will definitely do very well. Most of these brands, by the way, are growing double digit. But the real benefit comes from companies that go beyond their own self-interest, that work on broader transformations. How can we get industry coalitions together to get out of the issue of deforestation, 16% of global warming, small detail? How can we get people together to reduce the food waste, to create jobs for the smallholder farmers? Companies that increasingly understand that use their skill to drive these transformative changes beyond their own interest, will do well in the future. And that is my only plea as communications directors or others in the company, be part of that change, get actively involved. For the interest of time, I don't want to spend more. I probably didn't talk anything that is in this speech that Miguel gave me. Thanks, Miguel. But I do like to end and then open it up for a few questions for a second. I do like to end with someone I respect a lot, and which is the Dalai Lama, who said at one point in time that if you seek enlightenment for yourself simply to enhance yourself or your position, you miss purpose. But if you seek enlightenment to enable yourself to serve others, you are with purpose. So my only message to you is be with purpose. Thank you very much.
Have a seat. Thank you, Paul.
Okay.
Right. Well, I hope you enjoyed that as much as I did. I'm going to try and use about the next 20 minutes to take some Q&A, hopefully from you. Otherwise, I'll have to start asking questions to Paul, which I would rather not do. I'd rather hear from all of you in the audience. So. There should be people with roving mics, but anyone who would like to ask a question, I'll do my best to identify, but if you could just say who you are as well, that would be very helpful.
I can just talk really loud.
Go, talk.
How's it going?
Okay.
Good morning. Hi, Paul. Thank you for the talk. I'm Corey with Starbucks. You sound an awful lot like my boss, only with a Dutch accent. I think the question I would ask you, Howard, has talked a lot about using scale for good and about many of the themes that you talked about today. I wonder, is there a particular moment at which, as a CEO or a business leader, you made a decision to kind of turn the corner and get to philosophically the page that you're on right now in terms of what you just talked about?
No, I don't think so. I think, I came in from the outside as the first CEO that was brought in because probably the business wasn't going so well, and we didn't, unfortunately, have the talent internally at that point in time. And in order to be accepted, I spent a lot of time looking at the values of this company, what had made this company great. There's something about, Jim Collins' book, From Good to Great, he talks about nurturing the core before you stimulate progress. So here was this Trojan horse coming into Unilever. Some people thought that worked for our competitors and dramas. It wasn't up to me to expect being accepted. The burden was placed on me to be accepted. So I spent a lot of time looking at the company's values. And Lord Lever already in the end 19th century talked about something which he called shared prosperity. It was a term he used all the time. This was a man that was a contemporary, not to talk too much about him, but he was a contemporary of the Rockefellers or the Carnegies or the Mellons and many others in the US. In fact, they would pay homage to each other because when they would come into the UK, they would come into the ports of Liverpool and all the other things before going to London. But there was one big difference that I discovered. All those philanthropists, which have done great work, first earned their billions at today's money before they spent some back. Libraries, educational system, other things. Lord Lever was actually the opposite. He always spent before he had the business. This guy was hoovering on the border of bankruptcy his whole life. In fact, he died in 1925. Fortunately for him, not fortunate he died, but he died fortunately before the recession in 29, because he would not have survived that. And that's one of the reasons why our company merged with the Dutch in 1930, because we were basically bankrupt. But Lord Lever built houses for the workers before he had the factories. He created the pension system. He was the one in the World War I who got most of the volunteers to go to war in World War I by saying, we guarantee your wages and we guarantee your jobs when you came back. He just felt all that stuff to be normal. When he created Port Sunlight, he said the medical facilities or entertainment halls or sports facilities, he had a few rules that probably you wouldn't get by with today. No smoking, no drinking. Soon people discovered that people that lived in Port Sunlight were living longer than others, and studies started to happen. Why is that the case? But he very much believed in this shared prosperity. And I think that is actually the roots of this company that was successful. The reason that he created bar soaps, by the way, he called it Lifebuoy. A brand, by the way, that we were about to abolish when I came because it was too old a brand, the sales had gone down. But Lifebuoy in Victorian Britain was because at that time, one out of two babies didn't make it past year one. The issues of hygiene were here. Now they've just moved to India, Sub-Saharan Africa. So we're bringing that back to our brands. I only grew up in a family that I never realized that I was born in 1956. I never realized how close that was after World War II. But the older I get, the more I realize how close that was. And my parents had only one objective, to make life for everybody else better. We had six children. My father worked in a factory. But he worked two jobs just to be sure that we could go to university and have a better life, that there was peace in Europe. That's why the Brexit situation is such a tragedy. We've lost these deeper senses of purpose. But at least that's how I grew up. And it's quite a privilege to be able then to leverage a company like ours who reaches 2 billion consumers a day or is in 190 countries to drive that change. But what we find is by driving that change actually makes good economic sense. There's nothing I have compromised. We want to be carbon neutral by 2030, which is well before what the world needs. Europe is green already. In the US, we work with NRG and some other companies. We're greening. All these investments have less than 3-year payout. All of our factories are zero waste to landfill. I think waste is unethical. Just to waste something in itself is unethical. To waste a human being's resources is as unethical as to waste the world's scarce resources. You know, the world is 3 billion years old and has recycled everything it has. We've come along for 200 years with our industrial revolution and put the strains on the planetary boundaries. In 200 years, by not respecting this living in harmony. And it makes good economic sense. All of our factories that are zero waste have higher employee engagement, have lower cost, have higher quality. It makes good economic sense. So if we can get everybody to see this, increasingly so, the transformation to green energy is happening. Doesn't matter if you believe in climate change to me anymore. It's an enormous economic opportunity. In the US alone, 7 million jobs have been created in that field. The US is actually leading. Why be a climate change denier and put your economy on the back foot? This doesn't make any sense. And the solutions are there now, everywhere. So that's what we're trying to do in Unilever. I personally believe it, but it's not me that can do it with my beliefs. It's that everybody in the organization has to make that come alive. I'm just here telling the story. But what we found is that we propelled to the number three most desired, most looked at company in LinkedIn after Google and Apple. Totally unexplainable because Unilever is an abstract word versus Google and Apple. We have 1.8 million people applying to us every year, and in most countries where we operate, we are the desired employer. Again, last week in the Dow Jones Sustainability Index, we're off the charts, or GlobeScan on corporate reputation. Not that we're proud of that. I'm actually sad about that. I'm actually sad about the gap that I see between us and many of the others. Because at the end of the day, if we don't pull the whole world into that direction, it doesn't do anything. If I achieve in Unilever what we set out to achieve and nobody else does it, we have failed miserably. I still have a hard time coming home and looking my three sons in the eye. You see what I'm saying? So if we are not driven more by the stars, if you want to, in terms of how we guide our business, instead of the lights of the passing ships or whatever the opportunities are, we'll never snap out of that. So the crisis of 2007-2008, in fact, wasn't a financial crisis, wasn't an economic crisis, wasn't a governmental crisis. It's a crisis of morality. It's a crisis of morality. And the thing that we need to do most is to bring that moral dimension back to business. And it's not taught clearly in enough quantities anywhere. That's the issue. So bringing that morality back. So that's why I say what the world is most short of is leaders and trees. Anything we can do to invest in leaders is the best investment. And in fact, it's the young that get it more than anybody else. So investing in them, giving them a seat at the table, is one of the best opportunities we have to galvanize this agenda that I'm talking about. I hope that answered your question.
Okay, sorry, I'm looking around, so I'm going to go to that gentleman. I'll come back.
We can turn the lights down perhaps a little bit.
We can't see anything. It's just blinding.
Thank you so much for being here. Bill Chandler from Western Union, previously at Gap. Yeah. You talked about industry coalitions. I'd appreciate your perspective on successful industry coalitions you've observed and others perhaps that were less successful, and what's the key. And also you mentioned trade associations, and I share your view. But how do trade associations help or hurt industry coalitions?
Right. I have to say, I just was with your CEO at the Brazil closing ceremonies, and he's great fun. So must be a great company if you have a CEO that's great fun. But anyway, trade associations, if I start first with that for a second, you have to decide what you belong to. Trade associations have advantages, but they also have disadvantages. And you have to weigh out what is more important to you, to be honest. And it depends a little bit on your own business, your industry, your trade associations. It's difficult for me to generalize. I don't want to do that. But in general, trade associations drive to the lowest common denominator because they don't want to lose their members. So you get a compromise, and compromise is the worst thing. Tipping points are created by bringing few people together that create critical mass. The US and China coming together as climate change creates a tipping point in Paris. So tipping points don't need more than 30 of something. If I take the biggest producers and users of palm oil, I can create hopefully a tipping point in the countries where the issue is most prevalent. So I'd rather work on tipping points to move the world than on trade associations. Now, we have some trade associations that really, on issues that we feel very strongly about, are not aligned with us. Your ELAC in the US, which is an organization that probably serves its function, but we could not relate to that. We went out of that. The American Chamber of Commerce, who is a climate change denier of the highest order, we went out of that. Because it really gets to our values that are more important. Business Europe, we went out of that. And we actually find that more effective, more credibility on us. But that's because perhaps of our size that we can move these things forward. But we look at trade associations and we say, what are the issues that are most important to us? Now, Food Europe, for example, is obviously pushing the transatlantic trade agreements that we need to, globalization is an important thing. And some people think that goes against climate change. So they're attacking us and say, you're hypocrites because you're supporting transatlantic free trade, but it's stimulating climate change. I don't know how they all calculate these things, and yet you're supporting Food Europe. We are in Food Europe because we think the agenda is more important than we don't agree with all the arguments. So you make that balance on each of those. But we have halved our participation in trade associations, to be honest, more than halved. Freed up all that capacity and spent it on transformation outside. Which transformations are most successful? Obviously, you have to work on these issues that directly affect the companies. I understand that. I go a little bit beyond that because at one point in time, I was asked by the Secretary General to be one of the members of a high-level panel to develop the Sustainable Development Goals. So I spend a lot of time on that because I happen to like that. I think it's important. So we don't expect every company to do what we do. And most of the times, you get companies involved on issues that are obviously directly related to their P&L. The World Business Council for Sustainable Development of 200 of the most progressive companies is an ideal organization to drive these partnerships forward, because these are companies that are a little bit more progressive, or if I talk to Americans, I have to not use the word progressive, but use forward thinking. So you align yourselves with things that I think can achieve your objectives. With the partnerships that work best is where there's a clear aligned objective, there's no doubt about it, when there's commitment from the top, when there are clear measurements, and aligned measurements, when they are publicly made available, and frankly, when we feel comfortable enough in these partnerships to enroll others. I only work in partnerships where we have the right NGOs in, which is civil society, and governments, and that gives us validity. We're now expanding our tea plantations in Africa. We're doubling them because I want to create jobs for smallholder farmers. You give a 2-acre plot to a farmer, you teach sustainable agriculture, water management, soil management, and all the other things, they can actually send their kids to school and make a living. Nowhere near my salary, but they can make a good living. So we think in Africa, for example, where the continent is going to 2 billion people, we have to create the jobs there. We have to make them food independent. Otherwise, you get a lot more bored people, and you can see what the downsides of that is. Europe cannot accommodate that, if they like it or not, and that's what you see playing out right now. So, but we cannot invest alone. We just would, P&L-wise, would not be viable. So we work with DFID or USAID. We're one of the biggest cooperators with USAID. We're not even an American company. But we work with the high net worth individuals, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation or others, and put these coalitions together that also ensure that the farmer gets a fair end of the deal, that the commercial pressures don't make it only go to one part of the value chain, you know, the pay, but that it is fairly distributed, and to ensure that it permeates for the longer term and not depends on one individual. You could do it now, right? But what afterwards when these pressures increase again? So these partnerships are probably the most important part of it.
Mark? Thank you. I had a question over there. Sorry, I'm doing my best to pick out people. Oh, go.
Yeah, you want to?
Go for it.
Sorry, is it me? Okay, go. Sorry.
Go ahead.
Harry Yatman, all the way in the back, sorry. First of all, thank you for being here. I am a career CPG person. I spent 7 years at Unilever, and I'm delighted with where you're taking the company. My question is, so I spent, you know, Unilever and then Kraft, very, very different. And what I'm wondering is, you've set such a great example, and yet most of the American CPG companies, we followed with certain brands or certain categories, but we really haven't gone all the way. And I'm wondering, why do you think that is? Is it the shareholding? Is it the more activism in the US? What is it that is preventing US CEOs from going out there as far as you have gone with Unilever?
Well, I would not 100% agree on that, because obviously on the positive side, there are many great things happening in the US and many standards being set by many of the CEOs and their organizations. Without short-circuiting anybody in the audience, I can tell you 100. You know, we have about 30 American companies being part of the World Business Council for Sustainable Development, which I happen to chair at this moment. And there are many, the transformation to green energy, if you take that topic, you see many great American companies that understand that. Companies like Patagonia or Google now are actually creating that as a separate business. They're starting to understand it has an income stream that is actually very attractive. So there are many American companies that are moving forward. But there are a few things. I mean, culturally, I think the financial part is more important to Americans than some of the other parts. You know, I think that's inherently built into your culture, that success is measured with financial success. But you know, if self-worth is measured by net worth, it's not going to solve the issue. You have to get out of that. When I graduated in the US, my American friends were asking me how much I was going to earn. My European friends were asking me what I was going to do. So you have to make that jump, otherwise it doesn't work. And the MBA system has given us a great opportunity to develop this world. I'm a product of that. But it has given us a very limited view in tomorrow's world of what we need. So we have to snap out of that. And as a result, I think you need a lot more new leaders. And then you have these pressures. Wall Street in the US, I was once at the White House with Obama, and we were talking about development aid and some other things and what we were doing as a company. And he looked at me and he asked one question. He says, have you ever been to Wall Street? And I said to him, have you ever been able to stand up against Wall Street? The first meeting I had when I stopped giving guidance and I stopped doing quarterly reporting, because it's just nonsense. I'm not going out there as a CEO every quarter to talk about Ramadan being a week earlier or Easter being a week later or the weather changing, so I have to explain my ice cream sales of Ben & Jerry's and Breyers. I'm not going to live my life like that. I can't solve these things in 90 days, which, by the way, if you deduct the weekends, it's 72 days. This is ridiculous. So if we don't stand up to that, when I stop guidance and quarterly reporting, I had some guys in New York at a dinner I was hosting with the investment community tell me, how can I judge you and how can I be sure that you're a good CEO and this is unacceptable, etc. Well, I explained to him that in 1876 we already abolished slave labor in the Netherlands, or child labor. We're not going to introduce that again in my company as long as I'm there. And if he is not happy with this, put his money somewhere else. We shouldn't dance to the tunes of these shareholders. We should seek actively the right shareholders. 75% of the funds that are invested in the world are institutional funds. These are our pensions. And yet we're behaving like, and by the way, we're doing it ourselves. I challenge you, for all your companies, look at your own pension plans. We're all fighting the short-termism. Unilever has a 17 billion pension plan, 17 billion. We have over hundreds of thousands of retirees. So we provide a great function in giving people a little bit healthier, happier, longer life there in itself. Our pension fund is totally invested for the long term. Our incentive systems for the fund managers are long term. We sign up to the principles of responsible investment. I've decarbonized from coal in my pension plans. And by the way, the returns are great. We're one of those few companies that doesn't have a deficit. You know, you always have to restate when the interest rates go down, but we basically are fine. How many companies look at their own pension plans, which are, by the way, what these guys that we're accusing of being short-term are actually investing your money? They're not shareholders, they're agents. but they behave like shareholders. They behave like owners, but they're agents. So we have to stand up against that. By the way, CEOs also need to know how to better communicate with them. Most of the investment community wants to know more than P&L. In fact, most of the investment community is jumping on climate change, for an example, since Paris, at an accelerated rate. But they say, how can I judge companies if CEOs don't communicate it? How can I judge if there's not one standard, if it changes all the time, or if there's no transparency? But companies that publish, we publish about 50 targets, companies that publish, think about it, provide more information to the shareholders. If you provide more information to the shareholders, you take risks away, no? You take risks away. You give them more information. If you have a lower risk, you have a higher certainty for the shareholders. With a higher certainty comes a lower cost of capital. A lower cost of capital is a higher return for business. It pays out. It pays out. Companies that internalize climate change, publish and carbon disclose, have an 18% higher return on capital than companies that don't. We have the data now. There's enough studies around that. So be more transparent. I think the pressures in the US once more is certainly Wall Street, and you need to stand up. I'm on the US board. I've been in other US boards. I see that pressure. Shareholder primacy is most of the board discussions, and that's not very healthy. And the second one I have to say is your legalistic environment. We're a little bit more rebellious in Europe. We can say we're going to the UN Global Compact and sign up to their principles, or we're doing this or that. The US is always a little bit worried that they're getting then attacked, that they're going beyond and that it becomes a legally binding thing. In Europe, we're more relaxed about that. But having said that, I'm positive because I see quite a lot of US companies getting involved. Not enough, for sure. We're not moving fast enough. But it's definitely in the right direction. We'll take the last two questions.
He's even moderating for me now. This is great.
No, because it says time is up. It says time is up.
It says time's up down there.
Just time is up.
Thank you so much, Mr.
This is Polman, a very quick one.
Karen van Bergen, Omnicom Public Relations Group. Thank you so much for sharing this impressive success story for purpose-driven business. We're coming up to UN Week next week, the sustainability goals, the SDGs. There's still a bit of a gap I see in companies' behavior and the SDGs. What practical tips would you give us and our CEOs to be more involved and bring it down to our community?
No, thanks for asking. You're Dutch.
She's very Dutch, yeah.
Thanks for asking. It had to come from a fellow Dutchman. But I'll be there anyway on the SDGs. One of the things is... the SDGs are probably a little bit farther removed from people, or the awareness is a little bit more difficult to get across than just climate change. But climate change is actually a great way in. When we got the development goals in September, goal 13 is climate mitigation of the 17 goals. And in Paris, we got a fairly good climate deal, far more than people were expecting. And momentum is building. And companies are actually catching on. $34 trillion worth of capital in the financial markets is calling for a price on carbon. 1,000 companies are already internalizing their own price for carbon. The decarbonization movement is really picking up speed. We were hoping in Paris to have about $500 billion under management on decarbonizing by Mats Andersson, who was leading that from Sweden. We ended up having $900 billion, and now the number is already up, as I speak, to $2.6 trillion. The financial market is moving there. And interestingly, as the financial market moves, business pays attention. That is the flip side on what we just talked, but it's the reality about that. So we recognize, though, that the overall sustainable development goals are not so well understood. They're being seen as something for government or long-term or low returns for business. So the only way that we get a higher involvement is to create a higher awareness amongst the key business people about the power of the Sustainable Development Goals. So we've created this commission that served us very well on climate change. We created a commission which was called the New Climate Economy Commission that was chaired by President Calderon, former president of Mexico, Nick Stern, many others. I happen to have the pleasure to be on that committee. And we clearly changed the dialogue. The dialogue on climate change was, I have to make a choice. I need economic growth and jobs. I'm a politician. I need economic growth and jobs. I don't disagree. And if I go the climate change route, I'm actually not being able to achieve economic growth and jobs. So there was this trade-off thing. That commission really changed the political dialogue by saying, if I don't attack climate change, I don't have economic growth and jobs. So it's basically different sides of the same coin, which is the human development coin. It's a very integral part of this. And not surprisingly, climate change permeates all the other 16 development goals. Now we have created another commission building on this, chaired by Mark Mullock Brown, who was a major figure at the UN, which is the Commission for Business and Sustainable Development. And there we have a group of people sit together and look at how we can increase the awareness around the Sustainable Development Goals. Now we have obviously the UN Global Compact members, which are 8,000 companies, and that is totally run around the agenda of the SDGs. But how can we use companies with scale to accelerate that change? And that commission looks at new business models, new financing models, sharing the stories, and how to dialogue around the SDGs. I have great hopes that that, amongst many other efforts that is happening, will galvanize some momentum around that. And I think we're starting to see that happen already. But, you know, it's not easy. But you have the 169 targets, about, I would say, 80% of them have the involvement of business. And business needs to actively participate. By the way, just one fact, not to give you too many data, but all the governments together, I was mentioning that the Sustainable Development Agenda's implementation only needs about $2 to $3 trillion a year. Now, all the governments together in this world have overseas development aid, which is called ODA. The total amount of overseas development aid in the world is about $160 billion. It's good money. The UK has even put in law to give the 0.7%. The Netherlands, unfortunately, slipped to 0.5, which is a tragedy. But most of the world is giving 0.1 or 0.2. But at the end of the day, it's only 160 billion. So if it's 160 billion and we need 2 to 3 trillion, where's the difference going to come from? So business in most places in the world, if not all places in the world, is 60% of the GDP, 80% of the financial flow, and 90% of the job creation. So if business doesn't get involved, you won't get this agenda. It's impossible to implement. That's why goal number 17 that we put in is called partnership. And it's actually partnership beyond you and I working together to make it possible. No, it's partnership for the common good. It's the partnership for morality. There are three things most important in morality, in my opinion. The one thing is the respect and dignity for every individual in this world. Otherwise, you won't have morality. The second one is intergenerational. We have a responsibility not to ourselves, but to future generations. And the third one is to work for the common good. And all of those three are captured in this notion of partnership in goal number 17, actually, from the Sustainable Development Goals. But it's going to be hard work, but the best way to make it come alive, in my opinion, is ultimately, and I don't know if I will see the light for that, the day of light or whatever you say, is to have all companies report in their contributions to the SDGs. That should be the annual report. If a company can't explain what its purpose is, beyond its shareholders, which is not a purpose in itself, but if the company can't explain what its purpose is, I just have a simple question. What's the purpose of that business? And nowadays, if businesses are only staying in the CSR, which is basically less bad or part responsibility of a more complex system, if a business doesn't move to making a positive contribution to addressing some of these global issues, they will be voted out of office. The average length of a publicly traded company in the US now has dropped to 17 years, and it continues to go down. It goes down because we're not running it properly. We don't have the right leaders. We're running it for the shareholders. We've lost our purpose. It's a very fundamental point that we're at. And we're all shrinking the markets that we want. The financial market is being shrunk because less and less publicly traded companies. The economic market is being shrunk, making the problem even worse, as you now increasingly see playing out in these election cycles. And our businesses actually are getting shorter and shorter life cycles. So if we don't snap out of that virtuous circle, you know, it's not going to be pretty. But again, once more, to be positive, we have this answer. If we create that awareness to people, I think we can come quite a long way. And by the way, all these solutions that I mentioned to you, and we can talk this for hours, don't require more people to the moon or more PhDs. There's some technology that we want, carbon capture storage or battery storage technology if you talk about climate change. But most of the things we have, we know what to do. That doesn't cost more money. And by the way, the world has more money than it knows what to do with. We're not asking any money here. We don't need to pump in any more money. We just need to be sure that that money gets put to good use. And the payouts, once more, are tremendous. So no PhDs, no more missions to Mars to solve this. It's just it's basically what we need is human willpower. And by the way, that's a renewable resource in itself, so it's very attractive to me. We'll take the last question, Paul. Because then I have to go.
Yeah, you definitely.
Miguel, you have to intervene because...
I am trying to, but I'm failing miserably to moderate. Are we actually allowed to do this? Because I'm just conscious of... Well, one more question?
A simple question. Thank you for being here, sir. My name is Jim O'Rourke. I teach at the University of Notre Dame. I haven't heard a mention about subscribing to the GRI, the Global Reporting Initiative, which, of course, is headquartered in Amsterdam. Yeah, I'm wondering if you're an advocate for what they do and if you're encouraging others.
Yeah, so I apologize, obviously, in the interest of time, I cannot cover the broad range of all the things that are happening and many more that I'm not aware of, and GRI is one of them. By the way, great respect for Notre Dame, but your team, sports teams need to do better now. I have my my great friend, Pat Murphy. I don't know if you know him. So he's a great friend of mine and teaching ethics there, and a lot of respect for what you're doing at that school. GRI is obviously absolutely crucial because it creates the data set and the frameworks for this transparency I'm talking about. By the way, they're looking right now as I talk for a new CEO to run the organization because there's a change there that is happening. So if anybody has a great candidate, I think GRI would appreciate that. But it's a great organization. Many companies have signed up because one of the things you need with the investor community especially is you need the standards that are a little bit more uniform. Probably different by industry, I think. That's the challenge that we're dealing with. But within industries, you need to have some consistency. Otherwise, it's a little bit what some people might call greenwashing. And GRI is able in a very complex way to make useful contributions to this to the right indicators for environmental and social, for example. There's a project that GRI is actively involved in as well, which is called Redefining Value, which has a lot of funding from the Moore Foundation, who also believes strongly in this. And if you would not have organizations like GRI who represent a critical mass of business to drive these standards and be able to test that within the business community, you will not get there. So I wish actually that they would play a role, that they would play even a bigger role to be more of a convener of all the individual efforts out there. Because a lot of people are working pieces of the pie because they see what is happening, but they're diluting themselves. And so an aggregator in this effort is even more needed now. But a very useful role, without any doubt. Very useful role. Thanks for the opportunity. Thanks for your time.